Dyer's Band.
Hello and welcome back, guys, to Suit American Master 3 by G2A Team Unknown, taking on T-Show. Of course, I'm Chicago Ted. Joining me is Android. How do you feel about that game number one?
Hey, I feel confused. Unknown are one of the stronger teams in this tournament, but we saw T-Show absolutely get up and clean the floor with them. So hopefully T-Show have another great performance, but this might be Unknown saying, you know, oh man, it's crunch time. We got to bring our A game. So we're going to see some good Dota here regardless.
Yeah, good Dota indeed. I mean, I don't think Unknown are going to let this one go as easily as they did the last time. It looks like they do have three of their players instead of, I think they only had, what, two last game? So maybe we see a different team this time around. But obviously, T-Show are bringing their A game. They showed incredible resilience in game number one, or incredible composure, rather, and took a near-perfect game with a 15-minute GG. So it's going to be pretty tough. If Unknown, if they get tilted, then they'd probably be tilted right about now. Is that something that you just don't mentally come back from?
Yeah, to get cleaned up so completely is just, I mean, just awesome performance from T-Show. That anti-mage was absolutely out of this world. So we are going to see first pick Darkseer. Definitely going to be hopping into that offlane position. Super, super strong as he doesn't need anyone to babysit him. He can hold the lane all by himself, gets good farm with those iron shells, and just all around does a pretty neat job. So what do you think that Unknown are going to first pick? What do they need to get for themselves here?
Ember, Dazzle, Doom.
Well, Doom's banned out, but I do like the Ember Dazzle pick. Well, we saw Ember play kind of okay last game, but hopefully Ember Spirit is going to be the hero of this match compared with the Winter Wyvern. Great support, great duo, fire and ice right there, but they do have a really nice win rate this patch.
Yeah, and of course it does get a little hindered by the last game, but I do look forward to seeing their Ember Spirit play. They don't have, Aiton that plays Ember Spirit very well, or was Aiton their mid?
I think he's the Ember Spirit. I'm not sure.
Regardless of who he is, I know Unknown can play a fantastic Ember Spirit, but I'm not sure they have their big Ember Spirit player on their team right now, so it's going to be a toss-up to see how well they do this one. But T-Show, they grab the Darkseer Disruptor, a blast from the past, being a fantastic duo, and very powerful at that. I mean, Disruptor able to fight really, really early, and then his level 6 can be devastating for anyone like Ember Spirit or Winter Wyvern. Of course, Darkseer, once he gets his mechanism, he's near unkillable, able to grab a lot of experience out of the lane just by proxy of being close by, has decent escape, and can fight again from a very early point in the game, creating a brawling situation that I'm not quite sure Unknown will be able to stand up against.
Yeah, I think the Disruptor is just going to be fantastic. His ultimate is super strong. Once he gets the Aghanim Scepter, it's going to be, I honestly don't know how Unknown could team fight through that. It's going to be incredibly strong. If Darkseer gets a nice wall off in the middle of that, that's a one team fight. They don't need anything else. But T-Show still has three picks left to make this an unbelievably superb draft.
Yep, and they're going to have to deal with the Queen of Pain. Speaking of combinations, Winter Wyvern and the Queen of Pain being a very, very powerful one. Almost imagine maybe we see them follow this one up with something like a Witch Doctor. I'm not quite sure they want to pick up the Earthshaker from this point on. Earthshaker, oh, well, it's banned out, of course, but Earthshaker's had a very, I won't say bad, but not so great win rate for the past, for at least this patch, not really showing as much dominance as he did in previous patches. But Unknown, they go the Ogre Magi. Now I'm seeing this guy a lot more recently, and I'm wondering, is this the new Earthshaker, or is this the new Lion, or that hero that is a sleeper pick as a support but becomes incredibly popular because they're incredibly strong?
I honestly think so. If you just take a look at what he does, he has a reliable stun from a pretty solid distance. He has a nice damage over time. He has the ability to buff all his other teammates and his towers now, but that's kind of a cute little cheeky strat. And then he can do it multiple times in a row. He's just a really, really strong pick. He has awesome HP. He's pretty tanky, so he won't just go into a fight and die like someone like a Rubick or an AA with a very low HP pool. So I think Ogre's always been strong. I don't know if he necessarily got a whole bunch stronger. I just think now he's being incorporated into the lineups because he offers so much.
Right, and I mean, he typically synergizes with a heavy right-clicking carry. Now, Unknown, They don't have one of those yet, and it doesn't seem like they might pick one up. So that synergy is not going to quite be
Templar
there, but being
Assassin.
Okay, well, never mind. It is going to be there. Templar Assassin being the final pickup from Unknown. Three incredibly dominant cores coming out from Unknown. It's going to be very tough to deal with these three guys. But as I said, Tisho, they can fight very early, and they have a very powerful early game fight. Even throughout the mid game, they're strong. They don't quite have that late game that Unknown have fielded with these three kind of semi to harder carries. But Tisho, if they pick someone up here, like, I won't say a Spectre, but 5 seconds.
I'll say a Spectre.
You'll say
I think
Spectre.
They really.
Okay.
I think they need a hard farmer, a Spectre. They might not need the range from Luna, but I think Luna would offer some really nice team fight for them and just seal the deal with that disruptor ult. But I think they need a hard farmer, someone to just sit in lane, wait it out. I think even an anti-mage they could benefit from, someone that can hop around.
Am is banned out here.
Oh, he is banned out. Yes, I did not notice that.
White like Spectres. I don't think she's got the same synergy with a hero like Darkseer. Of course, you want to try to get a split up fight where you can get as much desolate damage off as possible. But I guess she is definitely strong in the fact that once she hits level 6, she can indeed fight. Being able to go after, you know, pickoffs or 2v3s or 3v3s and turn them around by bringing in extra meat for the fight itself. And maybe it's strong enough to deal well in this game, but a Spectre would have to go up against someone like a Queen of Pain, which is never something you want to do. Melee carry against the Quap, usually always very difficult to fight.
Yeah, I look at Unknown's lineup and I see just unbelievable burst damage. They're going to take like 5 hits to get anyone down across the map at the beginning of the game, and then by the end of the game, TA could probably one-shot the Windranger if it's lucky. So, Templar Assassin, Ogre with that awesome stun, a couple Sleight of Fists from the Ember Spirit, and pretty much anyone on Tisho can be killed, so I do think their fifth pick here needs to be very tanky or very resilient. Maybe even someone like a Sven? Would that be reasonable?
Sven would be reasonable, but it will be that Spectre. All right, we talked her to death, so now it would be a shame if we didn't actually see her. But I would have liked to see a Sven. And my problem with Sven is that he doesn't chase a hero like Templar Queen or Ember Spirit. Killing an Ogre Magi is incredibly difficult, and Winter Wyvern as well. He just gets kited way too easily, so I'm not quite sure I would have liked to see it here, though they do have a lot of spells to help that out. The Spectre will end up being the pick, and now that I think about it, you know, it did seem like one of the better ones, but they've got to really protect this Spectre, as going into game lane again against Queen of Pain is going to be a little difficult. As we come into the game, we have a little bit of a pause, but I don't imagine it to last long. Let's go ahead and introduce our teams. This time for the Dire on Unknown is going to be Ryoku Yu on the Templar Assassin, with Hoshimiki playing the Winter Wyvern, Zetok on the Queen of Pain, the bonus on the Ogre Magi, and Galindo Rosales playing the Ember Spirit.
All right, on the side of Tisho, on the Windrunner, we're going to have Sis. Playing the Darkseer is going to be King RD. Baga's going to be on the Disruptor. Our boy Therence is going to be playing the Spectre. And finally, Kierdo, Sarah Human, is going to be on the Tusk.
All right, for those of you just joining, this is Tisho going up against Team Unknown for the best of 3 winners bracket finals. Tisho having a 1-game advantage in this series. I'm not alone. I'm being joined by Android and Lurkaderp on stats. So thank you very much for tuning in, and thank you to all you right, both for helping out with this cast as the unpause has come through, and now I start to see where these lanes end up coming out to.
Yeah, I think the Templar Assassin is going to do really well in lane. I think if she can hit through the Windrunner, who I presume is going mid, I don't think there's really another option here. But I think the Templar Assassin, as long as she can live through the power shots from the Windrunner, is just going to dominate here in terms of last hits. But I could be wrong.
I don't know. I think Windranger is very dominant in the last hits. And it comes down to, you know, you got to get used to the attack animation first. But once you do, it comes so easy. It's kind of like a Drow, except I guess a Drow is a little bit more of a disgusting attack animation. Takes so long to actually cast it. But it should be a fairly easy hero to dominate this mid lane. And of course, Templar Assassin, not the easiest to go up against. And it will end up being, you know, once the Refraction Shield is down, if she doesn't go multiple points in Meld and Refraction, or at least doesn't have them up yet, then it should be a decent lane for her.
Yeah, I should point out that there's kind of been a party down here in this Radiant Jungle where Z-Talk as well as the bonus have just been in this jungle walking around. I think they've scouted out a couple members of the Radiant, but haven't decided to go on them. The Ogre has not leveled up anything, so he does have a stun available if he needs it.
It doesn't look like they will be able to use it. As top lane, we have a little bit of an engagement here. Now, it's going to be a Searing Chains come out, but those don't last at all. Galindo, he's just going to get brought down on the top rune. That's first blood for Sis, and a very nasty kill to give up on your Ember Spirit.
I mean, he got the bounty rune, though. That's something. No, but
no, it's not worth it.
Honestly, the first blood was just a huge loss, and that Ember Spirit, not only is he going to just die and lose that gold and lose that time in lane, but it's just he needs to be farming constantly. He needs to be in that lane getting XP and getting the last hits.
Right. And it looks like this is going to be a kind of weird lane up top, as King RD should be able to dual ion shell down and completely dominate this one as a melee to melee. Bottom lane, a very aggressive maneuver coming out from the bonus and Z-Talk, but they've got Kyrados Air Human down here looking for the snowball. He's still only level 1, hasn't put any points into anything just yet. So it looks like they're not looking to get any really that aggressive here. As Sis, there was a danger of a gank coming in onto him, but that danger is gone now, and he's just farming it up.
Yeah, I mean, Windrunner and Templar Assassin both doing pretty well in the last hits. It is the first wave, so we can't really say much. But this bottom lane, it's going to be so difficult for Ogre and Z-Talk. I think just having that constant harass from the Disruptor, who decides to opt for Thunderstrike first, so definitely going for that heavy harass babysitter build, and then Tusk with such high kill potential once he gets a couple levels. I think Z-Talk always needs to be scared and is going to be forced to level up that Blink pretty soon.
Right, and I don't know. The fact that he doesn't have a point in anything just yet kind of leads me to believe that both teams are just kind of trying to wait and see what happens. But top lane, it looks like King RD might be dead. He's going to surge himself away. He's got the salve, gets canceled by the range creep, but he's juking. And it looks like these jukes will end up working out as the ion shell has been wearing down Unknown's HP pools. And it means they can't continue to chase without risk of actually being brought down themselves. So a pretty interesting little attempt there from the Unknown dual lane. And right now, T-Show's King RD doing really, really well.
Yeah, the Darkseer, again, just so strong, because especially against two melee heroes, just pop on that Ion Shell, and I mean, Unknown are going to be forced to take the damage of that, but down bottom, we are going to see a little bit of engagement as Z-Talk just tries to go in. It's a little bit harass off on Therence, but nothing huge.
Yeah, this is the Shadow Strike level up here. That's exactly what we see usually against melee save laners, is you just spam that Shadow Strike out. I think she's waiting for level 3 so that she can spam it and does a little bit more damage, doesn't waste her mana with the level 1 Shadow Strike, but that it's just such a strong spell to have when going up against the Spectre. It makes it near impossible to really get close to the wave, because if you do, well, yeah, you're just going to take a ton of damage and be constantly below half HP because of it.
Yeah, I mean, who do you think's coming out on top in this mid lane right now? It honestly looks super, super even to me. And oh, here we go with the Tusk coming in with the gank. Ice Shards is slightly off the mark with the Ion Shell doing what he can. Nice work by the Darkseer. Good rotation in. There's no refraction, and the Windranger gets a kill on the TA. So, yeah, lane secured, I guess.
Yeah, and that was Kyrados the Human. He goes in for the body blocks, and it ends up working out for him. This is a very nice kill for Sis to have. He got first blood and the second kill. So it's looking really good for his farming. I'm not sure what he decides to go for. It looks like he's going to drop Phase Boots first as he picks up the Boots and Blades of Attack. Needs one more, but that's no problem for him. But after that point, do you think this is going to be the standard Aghanim's build, or do you think he's going something like a Force Staff or a Blink first? Or where do you think this Sis goes with all this gold?
I think the Aghanim's build is tried and true, and I think there's going to be some sort of critical point where the Ember Spirit starts coming online, the TA starts doing a bunch of damage, so the more towers that T-Show can have down by that point, the better. I think getting the focus fire off cooldown very, very quickly to have to use on those towers is going to be super crucial, so I'd say the Aghanim's build, but we could even see something really, really cheeky, like an Orchid or something like that.
Orchid, I could see it. I'm not a huge fan of it, but hey, if it works, it works, right? So we'll see what he decides to go for, as of course the choice is all his. But right now, he's doing really well, having all the kills on the board, and of course none of the deaths, as well there are no deaths for T-Show currently. And Sis continuing to just bottle crow it up, but a very slow game aside from that. Therence is sitting on the bottom lane trying to farm up, but only 5 CS to his name. Meanwhile, Galindo Roseo, he gave up first blood. It looks like he might drop again. The Iron Shell flying through. He's in a lot of trouble.
Down bottom, Therence is going to be going down here as Z-Talk just goes in, gets a quick kill onto the Spectre.
Well, that's an even more important kill than what just happened. You keep the Spectre down, you keep her from being really any trouble in the game. And this is going to be one of those games where I think Therence may have to just cut his losses and go for a bunch of really small items to try to farm up, you know, the jungle, rotate around, be a part of the early game team fights, because it's obvious right now, Russian Radiance is not going to happen.
Yeah, I was just going to say, Radiance seems off the table. He's just not getting the farm he needs to and doesn't feel safe enough to carry around that much gold at this point, as Z-Talk has such a high kill potential, especially comboed with the stuns from the Ogre.
Right. The kill potential, again, the Shadow Strike is abysmal to fight up against whenever you're a melee safe lane, so just not a great lane for the Spectre to be in. Of course, we talk about the supports having to protect her. It doesn't seem like that's been as easy for them. Looking at the fact that, I mean, again, he did end up going down. It seemed like he went down without really anyone close by to help him out. Maybe save Baga. What does he do? He doesn't have kinetic field. And
mid lane. It looks like Templar Assassin's going to take some damage here. The ice shards are on the mark, but there is going to be a meld, and the ion shell is going to do the work here. They don't even need to have any vision, and that's going to be a really, really nice kill.
A very awkward kill for the TA. Going down to that ion shell sucks, but it becomes a point where your fraction shield, it does nothing. The ion shell will bring it down in a short amount of time, and then what do you do from there? Well, you meld, but you're not going to be able to blink away. They probably will have some vision for you. If not, they just keep dropping the ion shells down, and you'll eventually die.
Yeah, it's certainly not easy. And I think as a Templar Assassin, she can put out so much raw damage, but like, how does she stand up to Tisha? She needs a blink dagger, she needs a four staff, she needs something to get herself out of danger, because there's so much lockdown on the side.
The juke's coming out from Baga. Now they might be able to turn this around in the bottom lane. Juking it out again. Z-Talk in a lot of trouble. He'll go down. Now they chase onto the bonus. They'll glimpse him back, put him right in the middle of four. And just like that, sis, he's got 3 kills to his name. Does he find a fourth? As the bonus dropping very low, it looks like Therence will end up grabbing that kill. And a 2-0 in the bottom lane. What a juke from Baga.
You could see him just standing there accepting his fate when the Ogre was cast in the ice shards. He was like, all right, I guess I'll stun someone on my way down. But goes down, clean kill. Tisha are 5-1. I mean, we said there was going to be some good Dota, but this is just so relaxed. You can feel the tension on both sides, as if Unknown lose this, they're knocked down. They only have one chance to get back up in this, and that's to play another series.
I believe this came out, though. If they lose this game, they get 2-0'd. They do have a chance, or they're guaranteed at least $500. I mean, we're in the top 3 teams right now. Tisha, Unknown, and Leviathan are the top 3. So one of these guys is going to be 3rd place, 2nd, and 1st, of course, obviously speaking. But they're still in the money if they lose this game. Getting the 2nd place, that you want to do that, because more money is better money.
Theron's bottom lane is just going to get stunned up and cast some damage on by the Ogre, but nothing too serious coming out. It looks like Therence was just kind of AFK in lane, maybe doing a little shop in there.
Yeah, it's again, it's a tough lane for Therence to actually have to deal with, but looks like top, Tisha, King RD, he's going to take a little bit of damage from the Flame Guard. He'll hit him with the Searing Chains too, and the triple Remnant activation. Galindo Rosales, he's farming incredibly well, has a pretty decent CS count, but also getting that solo kill.
Bottom lane, we are going to see the bonus go down. Really nice power shot, securing Sis another kill in this game. And now a glimpse back is going to take care of Z-Talk. Z-Talk blinking out before anything can stop her. But again, quick, easy kill onto the Ogre Magi. Tisha are very much in control of this game right now.
Yeah, it's at this point they really wish they had the Static Storm on Baga. Being able to glimpse right into the static, there's no way you get out of that one, so it's going to come to a point where Tisha, they got to start to focus down getting this experience out. As it looks like no wall has been leveled up on King RD, doesn't even need it, but all the vacuum back, he's going on to Galindo Rosales. Remember, he triple activated Remnant, so okay, he's got one Remnant to get out right now, but he's going to bottle up. In fact, turn this straight onto King RD. He wants to kill, but it's a double ion shell. The Searing Chain's doing a lot of damage, and looks like neither one will get the kill, but both dropping very low as a result of that play.
Yeah, I mean, Ember Spirit, he's doing pretty well. He is the top net worth for his team, and he's gotten a lot of free farm up in this lane. He's getting what he needs to get, but he's just not having the game impact he needs to right now. He's 1-1-0, and I would like to see him rotating a little bit more, having some more kill participation.
Yeah, there needs to be a lot more just kills on Unknown to really do much in this one, as and they're trying for it. You can see they've got a couple of aggressive maneuvers, but they're just too few, too far in between. And none of them have really worked out in their favor, aside from the one that they got, of course, a solo kill onto Therence. But it looks like maybe they go in towards a river. They find Sis, but he's going to go ahead and get a haste rune. He's also got the Windwalk, or Windrun, rather, and he'll just run away. No, he turns. He wants to fight. He finds the bonus. We'll continue to chase him down. They get him with a kinetic field. That locks him in place. Turn around. Throws out the fire blast, but in comes the spectral dagger. The slow being enough. The power shot through. And Sis will find himself a mega kill.
Yeah, those power shots have been absolutely on the mark. We've seen them secure at all three of the five kills on the Windrunner have been just to an awesome power shot.
Yep. And looking like King RD getting pretty close to that mechanism, although he has had a little bit of trouble, some road bumps, as Galindo Rosales actually gets the bottle and boots of travel out. Pre-10 minutes. This is fantastic for the Ember Spirit. He can pretty much free farm, do whatever the hell he wants, sit in the jungle if he wants to, and not really worry about the harass he's taking. The farming opportunities for this guy are limitless, and that's going to be a real problem for Tisha, as their farmer is Therence, but he is not doing incredibly well. They have to rely everything on Sis, and I don't know if he's going to be able to have as big of an impact as he's having at the moment for too much longer.
Yeah, I mean, you said Therence is their big farmer. He is just absolutely struggling. He's sixth on the net worth chart, which is not where you want to see a Spectre who's had
On the top lane, there's going to be a Shackle, and they give the kill. Okay, no, Sis will take the kill. Looks like they were going to give it to Therence. But he goes and haunts for that kill and gets up for some experience and assist gold. Not going to be the most gold, but more than he would have gotten on this bottom lane, as it seems like Tisha are going to turn that into the push on the top lane. Unknown using the space to try to put some pressure on the bottom tier one, but a TP out, yeah, that pretty much secures the depth of the tower. Therence, with now an Urn of Shadows completed, going for the early game fighting build, as I'm not sure how much investment he can make into his late game just yet.
Yeah, it looks like Unknown aren't going to push this tower too much, but it looks like they will be losing their top tower. They are going to pop the Fortify, but that's a couple quick kills for, or quick hits for Therence, and that tower's his.
Yep, and they do give it to him too, which is fantastic. He gets a good amount of gold off that one. The tower bottom, tier one, will still fall. It seems like they're going to give this one to Z-Tok now. Oh, wait. Maybe.
The Dire.
Wow.
Siege creep. Or little Dang range creep got it, I think.
Wow, that's even worse. Oh, man. But in the end, though, it's looking like Ryokugyu and Therence, or not Therence, the Galindo Rosal, are farming both incredibly well. Now, they are behind Sis, but that's not really that bad of a thing, as Sis has been farming out of his mind, getting kills all over the map. It comes down to the fact that, yeah, they're behind Sis, but look at their position relative to Therence. 2k ahead of them, and this is Spectre, a hero with relatively no comeback mechanic. Aside from hoping that he can sustain in the jungle, maybe they have some stacks for him, maybe get some lifesteal. But majority of the time, he just has to wait for his ultimate to come off cooldown and try to join a fight for a pick or two.
Yeah, I think the only way Spectre's going to get back in this is if he's spoon-fed kills, if he haunts into a very low hero that his team is holding for him. I think Therence isn't able to just go and initiate and get a kill on his own right now, and that's not where you want to see a Spectre at almost 15 minutes in the game.
Right, now this Urn is going to help him a lot, but they've got to start putting some souls in that pretty much as soon as he buys it, which was a couple minutes ago. So fighting is going to be very important for Tisha from this point forward, as the more kills they get, the more assists they can get onto Therence, the better. And it seems like they might be able to find Hoshi. Now, if they just pop a haunt right now, they get him. I think that they're so close to it, but they don't exactly know. Now, maybe they see the damage getting reflected into the trees. That gives them the giveaway, but no. Hoshi will TP himself away. And no kills as of yet for Tisha after that Urn pickup.
Yeah, but Theron's getting some much-needed farm in his safe lane.
Yeah, this extra CS that he's getting is really helping out his farm, but the big thing here is that there's no real pressure on him as he's farming that. As you said, the free farm that he's getting here is going to be fantastic. I imagine Unknown might put some pressure on him soon, but we'll have to wait and see.
TA taking a triple stack of Ancients, that feels really good, as she does just go ahead and finish off her Desolator from that. That's going to be a really scary TA, and this might be the window we were talking about, where Tisho, they have a great job on the Windrunner, she had a really nice start, but then as soon as Templar Assassin starts doing some raw damage, Tisho are still pretty squishy, so they really need to start watching their positioning. They might not be in as much control as they think they are.
Yeah, I think that's the most important thing to stress here. They're not in control of this game. The gold and experience grabs are both actually in Unknown's favor by a fairly wide margin, considering Tisho are ahead in the kills. So just the fact that they're getting kills is not enough. They have started taking some steps to alleviate this. They have been farming Therians, as we've noted, but they've got to do more. They've got to find picks. They've got to get kills, and they can't let themselves become comfortable. They always have to go for stuff, and as it looks like, maybe with a Haunt coming through, the top lane is where he goes as he's struggling to find anywhere to go to where he's out of trouble. And, of course, he does end up getting away, but that reveals Unknown. At least they know where Hoshi, have a general idea of where he is in the bottom lane, but they're not going to make a go instead. They see two by the wave, but it's just going to be a slow play right now.
Yeah, slow play indeed, but I think the longer Unknown wait this out, the dirtier the Templar Assassin is going to get. She's already top on the net worth chart, followed up by the Ember Spirit, so that's a big change from what we saw just a couple of minutes ago.
Yeah, and this is the kind of Dota that we know Unknown to play. They may have had a bit of a struggle in the lanes, but they will out-farm you. And just by doing that, they will do a lot as King RD, he ends up bringing down Hoshi Miki. So they did end up going on the Winter Wyvern in the bottom lane. But as it's happening, yeah, you lose Roshan. And that's going to be an Aegis going the way of Ryoku Ryu. Becomes very difficult to fight this Templar Assassin. As you said, just becoming dirtier and dirtier by the moment.
Yeah, I mean, the Templar Assassin, she's starting to hit her peak, where she can just farm really fast, get kills, be absolutely unbearable to go up against. And her only weakness is that, yeah, she has a Refraction, but after that she only has 1100 HP, so she really needs to watch herself and make sure she's in good situations. There's going to be a smoke out onto the Dire. They're going to rotate into the Radiant Jungle, should run into Tusk very shortly here, and it looks like the smoke will pop. They know someone's here. The Templar Trap is going to go off, and it looks like the Kinetic Field will not catch anyone, but nice Arctic Burn is going to kill the Disruptor, and there Z-Talk with the Sonic Wave is going to go into Sis, but it looks like a Walrus Punch won't be successful, as Unknown is going to get the pickoff on Tusk. And now it looks like Sis is in some trouble here, as Z-Talk is going to get the kill on the Windrunner. Theron's trying to TP out, and will just barely not get away. The Ogre Magi Burn, I believe, was the damage that secured him dead, even in the well. So that is going to be a four-man-for-nothing wipe on Unknown. Templar Assassin still sitting on the Aegis of the Immortal.
Yeah, about an 2800 gold swing. Pretty casual fight, if you ask me. In all seriousness, that was Unknown showing just where the golden XP grabs were telling us. They completely dominated that fight. And Tisho, they had nothing to deal with it. It seemed like they thought they were stronger than they were. They had a little bit of hesitation with their retreats, with their movements. And it became just a fight they could not take. And as you see, as you said, four for nothing. And Unknown are now getting close on the kill score, but the golden XP graph showing that they are well in advantage, coming up on 7,500 net worth advantage, although just shy of right now, very close to 10,000 experience advantage. And this is wildly out of control.
I think that Tisho, they needed to be more in control. They needed map objectives. They only have one tower down, and they really, really needed to be at least tapping on the tier 2s at this point, just to show that they're still in the game. But I think Sis is really the big hope for Tisho, and she doesn't even have her Aghanim Scepter yet. She really needs to be a little more farmed than she is. And if you take a look at the net worth distribution, it's, well, it just was three Dire Heroes on top, and now the Windrunner is trade. There we go, three Dire Heroes on top once again. So all of the carries on the side of the Dire are now more powerful than the side of Tisho.
Yeah, and Ryoki Gyo, he's just gonna lay into Therians. One, two, three, all it takes to bring down the Spectre. Now they're gonna ping out thinking there are wards up on the high ground, but no, they're actually on the low ground. And it's gonna be out of range, so they had no idea where this vision was coming from. And in the end, it actually just came from a very ballsy maneuver from Ryoki Gyo, moving in without very much vision, though he does have an observer ward out here. The kill that he found was actually by the medium camp. And yep, they're gonna throw sentry wards all over the place, but not find it. Finally, they find the right one, and that takes three sentries to get rid of one observer. Not really that worth it.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's just showing how scared Tisho are. They don't want to be without protection. They know that now Templar Assassin could go in and just melt people. Melting down the Carry Spectre in 3 hits, that is absolutely not what you want to happen. This Spectre is really, really struggling, still sitting at 6th in the net worth chart. And now, I mean, she's behind the farm of the Darkseer. That is just... How does the Spectre get back in this?
I think she's doing everything she can to get back in this. Go for the mid-game items and just stay her way.
Courier went down. I didn't see what it was carrying, but...
We'll see in just a second. He chose the TP out, but it will not be successful. So he should just drop here. The Mel comes through the last hit, and the Courier for the Wind Ranger, not exactly worth it. That did have a bunch of items, it looked like. An Aghanim Scepter completion. That was Sis's Aghanim Scepter, actually. Oh, boy. And the Observer Ward. Dang, that's a lot of gold going down right there as Galindo Rosales up on the top lane. The Sleight of Fist to bring down King RD. And God, this game is now going really south for Tisho as Unknown, showing that they are not going to let a 15-0 sweep completely wreck their morale. They come back 20 minutes in, 9-9, but the Grads are showing an absolute slaughter in favor of Unknown.
Yeah, I mean, it's only 20 minutes in, and team net worth is over 10,000 in favor of Unknown, and that's pretty much the point of no return, especially when you have a hero like a Templar Assassin that's just gonna get more and more disgusting as she gets more farm. She has 3,400 gold in the bank, still has that Aegis for a couple more seconds, I think, it's almost out, but has that Desolator, and she's just been critting like a madwoman.
Right, and I mean, getting that above average Desolator, too, that just secured so much farm on her, and it's making it so, again, she can just burst anyone down she wants. We saw that melt strike onto Sis, how once that wind run came off, it brought down 80% of her HP or something crazy like that. It was an immense amount of damage in a very short amount of time as there's a boost of travel up into the top. Galindo Rosales getting very aggressive. He'll throw back a defensive remnant just to secure an escape if he needs to, and it looks like that'll be enough for Tisho to say, yeah, it looks like we're not going to go in this one, though. Z-Talk, he's got a different thought in mind. Hanging back, though, and being patient.
Yeah, I mean, I think you really don't want to fight into an Ember Spirit. The Spectre, she's not as spooky as she is. She has an urn and some treads, and that's pretty much it for her scary items. We are going to see the bonus up on this top. Just going to harass them down, showing that he has complete vision over the Radiant, and there is a team fight ready to go if Ryoki wants to take it.
If they bring down the Frozen Sigil, they get the Tier 2 tower. They still have the... they don't have the Aegis Immortality anymore, but they do have a BKB on Ryoki Yu. So he's got what he needs to straight up fight. But this might just be a game of bringing down all the Tier 2 towers, waiting for the Roshan to come back up again, and then going for your fight. But we'll have to see exactly how they want to play this one out, as 23 minutes in, I don't think they're in any real hurry to get anything done. They know they've got the game in the palm of their hands. They know that Therence has been completely and utterly annihilated thus far, and is probably a good 5 to 10 minutes away from the best Radiance timing he could have at this given situation. So, I mean, they've got no incredible pressure on them. A little bit of a lingering thought in their minds that maybe they shouldn't go forever trying to farm, but at the moment, it's looking decently in the bag for them.
Yeah, I mean, I think that Tisho's last hope is that they have pretty strong high ground defense. They have that Static Storm from the Disruptor, which is going to make it near impossible for anyone Unknown to fight into, so that's their ray of sunshine right now, but I don't think that they're going to get any stronger just by waiting it up. We are going to see the bonus be caught out. It's going to take a snowball in from the Tusk. It looks like he might go down here. Power Shot is not enough to secure the kill, but the Focus Fire is. Windrunner getting the kill on Ogre Magi. Now a wall is down, doing crazy damage to the Winter Wyvern. She goes down, and now Galindo Rosales is running for his life. Power Shot slightly off the mark. He's double damage, but he's running for his life. On the back lines of that, it looks like the Disruptor's gonna get picked off, and now Therence has to TP out, and Templar Assassin is ready to go in with some damage. The Ember Spirit trying to live through this, and looks like Sis is gonna take some heavy damage now as the Templar Assassin is unloading onto her. That wind run is gonna run out pretty soon, and she is just gonna melt. Z-Talk is now on a killing spree.
I don't know, that was the best possible situation that Sis could have gotten in that fight, but it was hilarious. They took an incredible fight, they brought down a couple of picks, but in the back of their minds, they had to have been known that Ryokugyu was not actually in the start of that fight. Once he showed up, things got very, very poor for Tisho. Now, they disengaged in a really professional manner, they moved out, they TP'd out, they got anyone that could get out away from that fight, and perhaps they didn't have to lose this. He went in for the Ember Spirit, had a TP available. Not quite sure if it was on cooldown when everyone else was TPing out, but he may have been able to get away if he really wanted to. At the moment, though, he does have buyback. And Tisho, they are probably fighting 2 of 3 or 4 of E2. As, nope, the rest of Unknown will move, make their way in and back out as a group.
Yeah, Roche is nearly up. Very short Roche respawn timer. He's up right now and ready to go, and it looks like he might be spotted out by the Pasonic Trap, so they can go right into the Roche pit. Looks like that will be the case. And it looks like Z-Talk might be taking the Aegis here as he has a free spot.
Yeah. I'd be surprised if we could see Aegis. I still think they give it to Ryukyu. I mean, he drops his bottle or his magic wand and gets that Aegis Mortality. And it's just so much better on the Templar Assassin, being able to blink in and not have to care at all about what they can do to you. Just, you know, play it very aggressive and not really have to worry about them being able to bring you down.
Drops the stick, grabs the Aegis, and that was just such a bold Roche from Unknown. They knew that there was nothing Tisho could do to stop them. They didn't put up any wards. They didn't have any lookouts. They just knew that Tisho were going to be turtling in their base, trying to do what they can to keep the creeps from pushing back in. The Spectre, she is so weak right now.
Yep. I'm really worried about this Spectre, actually. But 3,600 gold, we mentioned she did have a timing for that Radiance that would be better than really they would expect at this point in time, but it's still going to be rough even if she does get that Radiance, which I'm not saying she will. She still has to buy the recipe after the relic. Of course, she has to get the courier to the secret shop too, or herself, which is going to be very difficult, but it's still an extra sum of gold that she has to buy on top of the relic, and I'm not sure this game will last long enough. Now, if it does, then it might get a little tricky for Unknown, but they still have incredible team fight. And even with a 6-slotted Spectre right now, having a 6-slotted TA and a 6-slotted Ember will do just fine against that hero, or maybe even better, as you bring down all of her armor. Even though she does have Refraction, she'll still die pretty quickly.
Yeah, Templar Assassin goes ahead and picks up the Monkey King bar, so goodbye, Windrunner.
Yeah, no, there's nothing Windrunner can do, a Windranger can do. Sis, though, does have some decent damage between the Axe and the Crystallis. It's a very, can I call this a Reddit build? Because that's the build that was made popular by, I saw it become popular because of Reddit. But it's had a solid foothold in the scene because of just how powerful it is. Now, some Windrunners or Windrangers opt to go for the Mjolnirs and other items like that, but the Crystallis is where it's at. Lots of damage that can come out. Now, you just got to burn through the Refraction, and you can bring down the TA relatively quickly, but you've got to bring her down twice, as that Aegis Mortality is not going to make things easy.
Yeah, you've got to bring her down twice, but then if they focus all their energy on the TA, the Ember Spirit can just go in, Sleight of Fist, and Searing Change, and just melt down everyone else. I think that the TA is absolutely the most ferocious hero, but the Ember Spirit is going to get underestimated a little bit if they're focusing on her.
Yeah, and Galindo Rosales, he puts a very aggressive Remnant back behind the tower. Another one.
Two.
That's like making Tisho second guess. Like, these Remnants are down. If we get a little bit out of position here, he'll just jump on us. But they might be ready for him to jump. Hold on, it's going to be a Winter's Curse. Now he goes in. The Sonic Wave, Vacuum Wall. They've got the Setic Storm down, but what's it accomplishing just yet? Sis, he's trying to bring down Z-Talk, but the Cold Embrace is keeping Z-Talk alive. Now, Sis, there is nothing he can do. 3 dead. Make that 4 in just a short amount of time. King RD, the Mel, comes through. Ryukyu will get the kill. There is a Radiance completed, but I think that's at the cost of Theron selling. Not selling anything. He's just going to play this one with the Radiance, so I don't think they GG out here because they've got it also backdoor protection, holding out a little bit of time, but they lose one fight with that Radiance and they're dead. Maybe they even just lose now. They're going to buy back two. In comes the Disruptor. No haunt just yet. Theron, it's down for 80 seconds and a complete disengage from Unknown. Not going to give Tisho anything. That's exactly the play they need to make.
I mean, they got the Winter Wyvern, but that's really not saying much. We are going to see Ryokugyo getting caught by the ice shards. It's going to go in. There's a snowball on him, but the snowball will run out before he gets there. And now it looks like Templar Assassin's just going to go back in and melt the entire Radiant team. Beautiful Sonic Wave from the Queen of Pain. Z-Talk going in, doing what he can. There is going to be some more kills coming out as Tusk is going to go down. Ember Spirit has a double damage rune ready to go right now. Templar Assassin getting another kill onto the Windranger. And now it is going to be a double kill for the Queen of Pain as only the Darkseer and the Spectre are left alive. And what are they going to do to defend a base? As this Templar Assassin, she's just getting absolutely filthy.
Yeah, there's this backdoor protection, but they're just still laying in no matter what. They're gonna get this tower. Okay, maybe. Yeah, they get it. And there's the GG. When you lose towers under backdoor protection, it's over. So not quite as fast as last game, but Unknown showing that they're
Templar
not...
Assassin dropping her items.
Oh, yeah. They're not gonna go down without a fight. So the score finally being 13-20, Unknown. They'll tie up the series 1-1.